Morning students, now we will continue our economics lesson 1, GDP and its growth. In last class we discussed about economic growth and development. Now we'll move into the next topic of development path of Indian economy. Under that, first one is Human Development Index. It is an index introduced by Mahbub-ul-Haq, a Pakistani economist, in 1990 under our UNO. Mahbub-ul-Haq, a Pakistani economist. It is a composite index of certain parameters like life expectancy of birth, adult literacy, standard of living, purchasing power parity of the people. That is, we want to consider the life expectancy of the people. Basically, the life expectancy will differ for each country. For India, it is 65 years. Then regarding literacy rate, that is how far people are educated. Regarding India, it has become only 82% of literacy rate. Then standard of living of the people, it is based on the income, employment opportunity and education and health condition of the people. Then purchasing power parity, and it is based on the purchasing power of the people, based on the currency of each country. Regarding the purchasing power parity, the first country is China, second one is our USA, and third is our India. These are the parameters in calculating our Human Development Index. The UNDP, that is United Nations Development Program, prepares an index for all the member countries by compiling the data of each parameters. These are measured as a logarithmic function of our GDP. In that, they allotted rank for each country. In that, India secures, in 2018, India secures 130th rank among 189 countries. So, it secures 130th rank among 189 countries. Actually, we have 193 countries, but we are taking into account only 189 countries alone. The remaining countries are considered as very low developed countries. So under this Human Development Index, it is a standard value for all the world countries regarding our GDP. The next concept is Gross National Happiness. It was introduced in 1972 by Bhutan King Jigme Sinji Wangchuck. He coined the term Gross National Happiness in 1972, but later UN General Assembly passed the resolution in 2011 as Happiness Towards a Holistic Approach to Development, that is happiness as a concept for economic development. So this happiness can be achieved by four pillars. There are four pillars of our GNH. First one, sustainable and equitable socio-economic development, environmental conservation, preservation and promotion of culture, and good governance. Regarding the first one, sustainable, that is using the resources for present and maintain the remaining for the future generation, that is called sustainable, by providing equal opportunities to the people. The second concept is environmental conservation, that is maintaining ecological balance by preserving forest resources, water bodies, animals, birds in the natural environment. The third concept, our culture. The culture of the people may differ from each country. Even though we have differences, we must preserve our culture by promoting oneness among the people and respecting the feelings of each culture. So we want to preserve the culture of each country. The last concept is the good governance. That is, we need a good political system. The rulers must rule the people with good administration from the village level to the country as such. So if people are satisfied with these four parameters, they'll feel happy. So that is called as gross national happiness. And this gross national happiness, that is these four parameters, are influenced by education, healthcare, standard of living of the people. But this is a dynamic concept for each country of the people. So dynamic means it will change for country to country. Even though there is so many changes will occur, we want to maintain happiness by the good governance. So far we talk about the two concepts, that is our Human Development Index and Gross National Happiness. And these two concepts are related to the economic development based on the value of GDP, that is gross domestic product, and per capita income of the people. The next concept is developmental path based on GDP and employment. After getting our independence, we made certain policies and programs for the development of our country. In that, in 1950, we started the 5-year plans. Each plan gave importance for the each sectors of the economy. That is, first plan deals with agriculture development, second for industry, and third for creating employment opportunities, and fourth one for poverty alleviation, that is providing certain programs are made for the removal of poverty in rural areas and made rural development programs. In early days, we follow a closed economy, that is we follow a closed trade practices, that is we encourage the domestic industries alone. No any foreign investment is allowed in India. The 6th and 7th 5-year plans give more importance for the development of public sector, that is government owned industries like power generation, railways, telecom, LPG supplies. Government allotted more funds for these sector, and these sector create employment opportunities to the people. But in a due course, due to increase in population, that leads to decrease in economic development. So to overcome the economic problems, government introduced a new economic policy in 1991. Under this new policy, government encouraged foreign companies to invest in India. By the new policy, government is able to increase the GDP and per capita income of the people, and increase the literacy rate of the people. Due to advancement in science and technology, life expectancy of people will also increase, and we are able to decrease the malnutrition and poverty of the people in the country. So by achieving the new economic policy, our Indian economy easily move from agriculture sector towards the service sector. The contribution from service sector to GDP is more nowadays. So we are calling India as a emerging economy. The next topic is factors supporting Indian economic development. Basically, India is a second populous country in the world. So in India, we have fast growing population that supports our economic development. Out of total population, 700 million are under the age of 35 years and they are efficient to work. Then remaining 64% of population are capable to work efficiently, and we are following a strong legal system in a working place. That is, we are following certain rules and regulation very strictly to secure the labor force in our country. Then we have the English language speakers are more in our country due to advancement in education. And here, due to overpopulation, people are willing to work in low wages. And government is providing more facilities like free power supply, no tax procedure for the foreign investors, and attracting companies towards India. Especially more IT companies are there in India. So we are considering Bangalore as a hub for global software business. In that, hub means a place where we can see plenty. That is, in Bangalore, we can see nearly 67,000 IT companies. So Bangalore is called as electronic city. So these are the factors supporting Indian economic development. Into the next concept of GDP and economic policies. That is, Government of India introduced many policies for increasing economic growth and development of the country. Under that, we have certain policies. First one is agriculture policy. It is a set of government decisions and actions relating to domestic agriculture. The example, price policy, that is implementing price for seeds and fertilizer and introduction of green revolution, use of high yielding variety of seeds for increasing agriculture production for the development of agriculture sector, that is agriculture policy. The second one is industrial policy, a policy to modernize industrial sector to create employment opportunities and to promote research and development and to make industrial sector as a self-sufficient one. If you introduce certain reforms in industrial sector, automatically that leads to increase in agriculture production and that leads to increase in trade and increase in transport facilities. So we can increase the service sector of the economy. So we want to give more importance for industrial sector. If we introduce many policies regarding industrial development, automatically the other sector of the economy will also increase. The third one is the new economic policy, which was introduced in 1991. Simply we called that as LPG, liberalization, privatization and globalization of trade. Liberalization of trade, that is open economy to encourage foreign investment towards our India. Privatization, that is encouraging individuals to own a business by providing bank loans and subsidies to them. That is called privatization. Globalization, that is world trade, that is allowing all world countries to trade in India, and same way India can also trade with other world countries. That's the meaning of globalization, towards the path of growth of an economy and to compete the world economy. We are following this new economic policies. Likewise, in different sectors we are following different policies, like trade policy regarding our exports and import, and employment policy, currency and banking policy regarding the banking sector. Also we have certain policies, fiscal policy, that is based on the tax rate of the economy, monetary policy, that is the interest rate provided in banks and our savings account. Then we are following certain wage policy and population policy, and these policies help to develop the each sectors of the economy, by which we can increase the GDP and economy, we can achieve economic growth and development. After the new economic policy, economic growth has been steady, stable and diversified. But due to some fluctuations caused by demonetization and introduction of GST that affects the economy, that is demonetization, that is devaluing the currency notes of 500 rupees and 1000 rupees on 8th November 2006. Then introduction of GST, goods and service tax, by the government of India in 1st July 2017, and these two affect the whole economy very vastly. So our growth rate is declined. World Bank projected the growth rate for India is 7.5%, but we are showing only 5.4% alone. India has considered as a fifth fastest growing nation of the world. The first one is Guyana, second is Ethiopia, and third Rwanda, fourth one is Bangladesh, and fifth is India. So we want to achieve economic prosperity, then only we can increase our GDP and we can achieve developed economy.